What happens to the students who major in biomedical engineering from this program? Over the years, about 40% goes on to medical school, 40% goes on to graduate school, and 20% go to industries like Philips and Siemens for imaging, go to orthopedic appliances manufacturers, goes to research laboratories and hospitals. We have people who've gone on to invent things and start companies.
Students who go on to work go to a very wide range of places. Part of that is New York City. Certainly some of our undergraduates go on to work in pharmaceutical companies, in medical device companies. We have a certain number of students every year, of course, who go to finance or go to consulting, go to things that on the surface really don't maybe necessarily have anything to do with having been biomedical engineers. Although, a lot of them will go, say, to finance and find out that in analyzing the biotech industry, they're very well armed because they understand what the technologies are, and when they read a description of a new technology that a company is promoting, they know enough to understand whether this is likely to be successful or not. So I think you find ways to use your background in other areas as well.
You know, with such a high profile, such an excellent program, we're, you know, top 15 in the country. Okay, that's not easy to be done. So, and that's why King's Columbia has a very strong reputation with the industry that I'm familiar with. And they're always asking me, can you send me students?
It's a very dynamic population because they're very, very bright. They can basically go to any job that they wish to go to.
There's obviously Merck, there's Johnson & Johnson, Becton Dickinson. I have a master's student who just graduated last year. She's now working at BND. And I think as biomedical engineering companies mature themselves, there will be more venues for them.
One of the consequences of being in a field that's very, very broad is that you do have to understand a lot of material, but you also have to recognize that no one person can know everything that is known in engineering, biology, and medicine. And so the way you have to solve that problem is, as the biomedical engineer on a team, you're the coordinator. So a lot of times, I think in industry, especially when our students leave and get a job, they end up assuming, whether they were intended to or not, the role of a coordinator on their team, because they're the one person who speaks all the different languages. And it's not unfair to speak about these different disciplines as languages. Each one of these really does have its own language. Medicine in particular, if you've ever tried to go to the doctor and understand what they're saying to you without trying to say, wait a minute, please speak to me in layperson terms, you understand it's a very foreign language. And so being able to communicate among people that speak different languages is something that biomedical engineers have to do in their careers.
The big research labs, Park, which used to be Xerox Park, SRI, GE. A lot of the, I've actually maintained very close relationships with the people I knew in industry. So I was at the David Sarnoff Research Center in Princeton, which is owned by SRI, and have been able to kind of use those contacts to help get my students and students that are interested in positions either there or at some of the startup companies that have come out of that that organization. I mean, I think that it all becomes connections, and what is important is that the more the faculty have interactions with industry, the more likely it is that the industry is going to pull their students in. So, you know, everything from consulting to joint projects with industry. Honeywell is a company I've worked with quite closely. Also in the government, if you work closely with, let's say, NIH, there's a lot of opportunity for students when they graduate, even if they just have a bachelor's degree, to go into NIH and work as a laboratory technician and see the environment at NIH, and then maybe decide that they would want to go back to graduate school, and NIH actually even offers, I believe, some financial support to do that.
I would say that most of our students go to medical school and graduate schools. And I think it's, some people are concerned about that, but I'm not. I think it's a good thing. I think everybody, if you can, education is not bad for you, especially in such a specialized profession as biomedical engineering. You know, and you have to learn all throughout your life. And I think that at the undergraduate level, I encourage my students to go to graduate school. Yeah.
The ones who go to graduate school Most of them do go in BME. BME is an exciting field, and most of them, I think, are excited to be in it and want to continue. But not all. The background here is very solid. They've taken an awful lot of science courses and engineering courses in a lot of different areas. And so we have students who go either to a traditional engineering department. So we've had students who go on to mechanical engineering or chemical engineering for graduate school, or decide that they want to do something more biology related and go to biology or biophysics. So I think the preparation is very good for going to many different places using biomedical engineering as a start.
Basically, everything is open to you once you have a degree here, because you're going to learn history, you're going to learn leadership quality, you're going to learn the technical aspect with great expertise so you can do things.